Good morning, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, also known as 287. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you're having a blessed and a peaceful Sabbath. Now, today what I'm going to do is do a response to a letter that was sent to my wife and indirectly to myself. And I'm going to share the letter and my responses to the young lady who wrote this letter because we can always learn, as well as I learn when I'm answering something like this, because I have to dig and search and be sure that I use what the word says in helping steer and guide someone in the knowledge of the Father's word, because that's what's going to help them, not my own personal self opinions, what the word says. So if the Father can inspire me and use me to help me share his word in a way that someone may understand, we can all learn from that. And I know there's at least one other person going through something similar, if not exactly the same. So I'm going to share that with you all today, and hopefully it inspires and helps someone else. So the letter starts out, "I approached you because you and your husband seem like people who can give sound advice from a Christian perspective." Okay, well, let me say this right quick. When it comes to Christianity and all those phrases, I like to stay away from using words like Christian and even terms that are associated with denominations, because you have to understand, people try and lock you into what they think they know of Christianity or Baptist or Catholic and all these different things. So when you say you are such and such, people think they know you, and those who are judgmental will be judgmental, and those who are on the fence will tend to lean toward what they think they know and judge you based on that. So I do things from what the word says, and that's how I approach things. But we all have to go with what we know. But that's just to give some basic understanding that for any of us, if we can come away from titles and being locked into what people think they know, because in every group, no matter what it is, whether it's a Christian or a Baptist or this or that, people will pin you to that. So if you can say, "I just keep scripture, I follow the Father's word," then people can only lock you into the word. And that's how I approach a lot of everything I do. And with that being said, I responded to her letter like this with the first part. "First, thank you for asking advice based on the word. I like to give all thanks to the Father and ask him to help me in addressing your concerns, because like I said, I can't do it on my own, nor do I want to. I want to do it based on the inspiration he gives me through the knowledge that is in the word." She continues on and says, "Long story short, I've gone through a lot of difficult situations in my young life. A lot of those things were out of control, just like many others I would have avoided. A great deal of the pain I felt was brought upon me without any logical reason, yet at the same time, a huge portion of it I brought upon myself with my actions. I've disappointed a lot of people, hurt them, let them down, made a lot of promises I never bothered to keep. We should all be willing to claim what we have done. That way we can deal with it. When we live in a state of denial and try and pin it in other directions and on other people, we have a long way to go before we can even get to a point like this." My response was, "First, always be clear to yourself. Don't ever think that there's no logical reason for something that you do. The simple answer is self. Whatever we do that causes pain, misery, self-gratification, or whatever at the expense of others, including at times our own self or body, is purely selfishness. That's it. Purely selfishness. In our lives, we have all done things to satisfy ourselves first and then let the chips fall where they may. Often people don't consider or care about the consequences until after they have done something. So don't think that you are a special and or a rare case in this area. Second of all, for all the pain and disappointment you feel you've brought on others, first seek forgiveness to heal or start to heal in this area." So simply saying, we can't ever think that we're the only ones who've done anything that's not right, and we can't ever think that there's no way out of it, but we always have to start with forgiveness. Now, James 5:16 reads like this, It reads, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that they may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Take note that the word says to confess your faults one to another, not to your mother, father, friends, sister, or even pastor. These people, especially clergy, should be telling you what scriptures say do. Now, I continue on and say, you address your concerns in this letter in a general sense, put specific enough to not give details. I don't need details because they are not my concern, and details can only supply people with something to gossip about as they would become tempted by the enemy. This is even truer for those you tell things to who are not in the Word. Make all reasonable attempts to address matters with the person or persons involved, if possible. Then next I reply, simply put, bring these issues face to face, if possible, with whomever they are with. Discuss, apologize, and resolve it. If it is that type of a situation that can be resolved, resolve it. Figure out a way to resolve it and let the matter be finished. If it's just a matter of apology and asking for forgiveness for your fault in the matter, do that. Some things are simply a matter of admitting fault, apologizing, asking forgiveness, and moving on. If it's a matter of restitution being involved, do so and make arrangements, if possible, to resolve that part. Always be aware that the Father won't forgive us unless we forgive. Mark 11:26 reads like this, but if ye do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive your trespasses. And I continue on and say, it starts with you. You have to forgive yourself. If someone else is at fault, you must forgive them. Whether they come to you or not, always forgive other individuals. Don't wait, just forgive them, because that allows us to move on. We have to free ourselves from the burden and sin of holding grudges and carrying hatred around, because that's what happens if we don't forgive people. That stuff grows and builds on us. This is made easier by first addressing the problems head on so that you may be able to let conflicts go. If you don't let them go, they become stumbling blocks in our life, causing more problems like bitterness, hatred, and anger. 1 John 1:9 reads, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, Matthew 18:15 reads like this, moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. Now, notice that scripture addresses fault from both sides of whomever may be at fault. Take note of this verse, though, in the second part. If the person you address listens and discusses, or quote-unquote hears the issue with you, you may gain that brother back. Now, be aware, the point is we have to do our part in resolving these problems. If we don't, they pile up to where the enemy can start to work on us as this individual, or as you are attesting to in this letter. Don't give him ammunition, don't give the enemy ammunition to bring chaos and destruction into your life. Now, her letter continues on and she says, I am aware that I have to change, take responsibility. However, the apathy I feel towards life is very overwhelming. I just don't feel like doing anything really, let alone fight to change things. Now, for those who don't know what apathy is, I'm going to read the definition. The definition of apathy is the lack of interest or indifference, enthusiasm, or concern. And that's the type of thing where people go, you know, I just don't care. I give up. That give up mentality. We have to not fall into Satan's trap. See, he's been working on this young lady's mind too long and too often with subtle thoughts and suggestion, and she's been taking them in, grabbing them, and now she's suffering from apathy, which allows everything else to flood her life. So that's disappointment, depression, whatever. Remember I did the video last week, the big D's. See, when you let the enemy in too long, he can start with all the D's. Now, she continues on in her letter and says, constantly I keep hearing all these testimonies of how God audibly and physically spoke to people and answer their prayers directly in ways they are truly mind-blowing. My response, having faith and trusting the Father allow these things to be more prevalent in someone's life. When you're living according to and studying the Word, the communication can be greater because we open ourselves to it more, which we do, people, I'm telling you. Romans 10:17 reads like this: "So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." Look, in part, our hearing comes from the Word that we have in us from what? From studying and diligently praying. So we have to study, we have to diligently study, and we have to pray, and we have to diligently pray. John 14:26 reads, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you." Okay, people, pay attention, because this is my response, and this is in part what we really need to understand about hearing. This is in part what we hear, what we put into us. The Holy Spirit brings it out to our memory because we did our part and put it in there. He can teach us from the knowledge we study. The Father doesn't force us to learn His Word, but we can't learn if we don't study. If you don't do your homework, the teacher, the set-apart Spirit, the Holy Spirit, has nothing to work with in bringing that knowledge to us. This is how He speaks to us in part. Look, people, we get out what we put in. When those of us who hear the Holy Spirit speak to us, He's not speaking anything different than what's in the Word. He's bringing it to our remembrance. He's reminding us of what we know, what we should and shouldn't do based on the information out of Scriptures that we have put into us. You know you shouldn't be doing that. Well, why would the Holy Spirit tell you that? Because you've put the knowledge of knowing that you shouldn't do this, that, or the other in you. Don't go over there. That's a place where the enemy is. Why would the Holy Spirit tell us that? Because we know, based on what we've studied, that we shouldn't go here. We shouldn't go there. We put this knowledge in us. So the Holy Spirit, or the set-apart Spirit, teaches us and reminds us and brings these things out of what? Out of our memory. We put it there. We put it in us. If we don't put anything in, we'll never hear the Father speak to us, because there's nothing for Him to work with. All we have in us at that point is the world. And the Father has no concern about worldly thinking and what the world does in terms of reminding us. So we have to put His Word in us, His knowledge. Now, her letter continues on, and she says, "I feel such a great despair whenever I hear it. I feel abandoned by God." Now, she said this in response to not hearing the Holy Spirit and hearing other people's testimonies. You know, it brings her to despair, and she feels abandoned. Well, I responded like this: you should be edified by hearing others' testimonies. She should be uplifted. We should all be uplifted when other people give their testimonies. If you are feeling despair and abandoned by others' testimonies, you may want to consider if the enemy is at work putting subtle suggestions in your head and you're grabbing hold of them and allowing them to work in your thinking. These testimonies should uplift you and encourage you in the faith that you claim by keeping your hope strong. Our hope is based on belief. We have to believe and hang on to it, trusting that the Father is true to His Word. If you don't believe, where does it put your hope? See, when we hear other people, like I said, that should inspire us. That should create a fire in us and a desire to want the same thing. We can't go into despair because we don't have it. We should be going, man, I want to have testimonies. I want to hear the Father. How or what do I need to do? That's the type of inspiration we should get from it. But if we go in a sense of basically envy and jealousy, or fall into despair and stuff because we aren't, then the enemy is going to eat us alive and work that in us. So when we hear these things, these fascinating and mind-blowing testimonies, we should want to find out, what do I need to do to get on board that ship? Now, remember what faith is. Hebrews 11:1 reads, "Now faith is what? Is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." And her letter continues on, "I always ask to be answered in a shocking way, only because if I get answered in subtle ways, my ego will find ways to twist it to see what I want to see. I need clear-cut, direct, and firm answers, signs in order to understand. I want to hear from him that he cares about me and help me sort out the mess I am. What can I do? And that in part was the last of her testimony to me, because that's what it is. It's a testimony of pain and sorrow. Now, I responded with Isaiah 65:24, which reads, "And it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer, and while they are yet speaking, I will hear." He's already answering before you ask. He hears you before you speak. He knows. He hears us. He loves us. Now, I'm going to continue on with my responses. First, when we have allowed so many negative distractions into our life, we cannot hear or understand because we have no focus. The enemy is busy working to keep us on this path through twisting suggestive thoughts that we start to entertain. See, we entertain this mess that he puts in our head because we have lost what? Our focus on the Father and his word. While the enemy is busy sending negative thoughts into our mind, we are trying to hear the Father on top of this chaos. This will not work. Sometimes we need to get to a quiet place and just pray in silence. We have to study the word so that the Holy Spirit, or the set apart spirit, can work in us. That thing we call a conscience is often the set apart spirit or Holy Spirit speaking to us. And when we are in the Father's will, as we should be, it is very clear and discernible. How many people actually listen or give credit or give the Father credit for speaking to them through the Holy Spirit? People, you have to understand and you have to recognize when the Holy Spirit is speaking to us, especially if you study the word. All these things and warnings and whatever that we hear that are truly edifying and uplifting to us, this is from the Holy Spirit. This is from the Father and his word. So keep that in mind. And I continue on and say, even when we feel that the Father is not answering our prayers, we can always know that he loves us. When we clear all the garbage out of the way and hear the Father speak to us, no matter how subtle, it is a clear, loud, and always mind-blowing experience for us, for any of us. When we move all the mess out of the way and we can hear, it's truly mind-blowing. Whenever I hear or have a testimony, it's always mind-blowing. So there's nothing not mind-blowing to the individuals hearing these things, and don't feel a sense of envy because others tell you their testimonies, that what they hear and what they see, and you don't. It's going to be mind-blowing for them also. And I continue on with my response like this. Even when we feel that the Father is not answering our prayers, we can always know that he loves us. Believe me, when we clear all the garbage out of the way and allow ourselves to be able to hear the Father speak to us, no matter how subtle, it's clear, it's loud, and it's always a mind-blowing experience for any of us. That's one reason why people always share their testimonies, because it blows their mind and it is truly a humbling, wonderful experience. So don't think that it's only a mind-blowing experience to you because you don't hear and you hear other people's testimonies. It's a mind-blowing experience to the individuals who hear from the Father in these ways. Now, Jeremiah 3:13 reads like this. It said, "The Lord have appeared of old unto me, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee." He has loved us always with an everlasting love, and he will never stop loving us. So don't ever doubt for a moment. That's the enemy at work. The Father has always and always will love us. The enemy wants you to think he doesn't. By what? By whatever you go through or by whatever burdens you. But see, we have to let those things go. The Father does not want us to hang on to that stuff. He says to lean on him. Let him take these burdens and pains away from us. And then finally in Psalms 147:3, it reads, "He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wounds." And my final response is, the Father can and will heal your heart and spirit. Commit sincerely to him and stay the course in being faithful. Trials and issues are truly a test of our faith. Endure and allow him to carry you through yours. Be blessed, my sister. And with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.